Welcome once again to Syntax Error, your pretentious, philosophical, pedantic podcast, ostensibly about video gaming and related topics therein. Warning, this podcast contains mature language, content, and spoilers. You have been warned.
Welcome back to Syntax Error. I'm Solid Snake, a.k.a. Scott Thurlow, here with Liquid Snake, a.k.a. Jane Manzer.
I'm in a box. A cardboard box.
And Venom Snake, a.k.a. Stephen Hermosi.
Snake!
And as you may have gathered, we'll sort of be... So our original intent for this episode was to try to explain, and condense as possible, the convoluted plot of all Metal Gear games. And, in fact, someone did it for us, named Alex Camilleri, has a site called MetalGearTimeline.com. And we tried to get in contact with him, but he's also developer at Calopsia Games, so we'll give him a shout-out either way. But he put together a timeline of all the games and has them sort of broken down and which, you know, what years fall under which game, which order they are. So before I pass it to Steve-O, the dates range from 1918 and it goes up until 2018. So 100 years. So within that, he has broken down, like I said, which game, like, here's the events that happened between these years and then this game happens here, etc. So Steve-O has shuffle those back together or put them in chronological order of the games, not necessarily the releases, just what game falls in, you know, consecutively to what other ones. So go ahead, Steve-O.
That's right. And I would like to say that, yes, from 1918 until 1963 in the timeline, it's all just backstory, so it's not actually in any
games. No games take place within that period, sure.
So here is the order of the game chronologically, of the games chronologically. The first one chronologically is Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater, which took place between 1963 and 1964. Then Metal Gear Solid Portable Ops was 65 to 66. Metal Gear Solid Peace Walker took place in 74. And then one of the newer ones, Metal Gear Solid Ground Zeroes, took place in 1975. Now, Metal Gear Solid 5 Phantom Pain picked up right after Ground Zeroes, but most of it takes place in 1984. And then there's the original Metal Gear, which was set in 1995. That game came out in 87, by the way, so it was a super
bit
futuristic
of a time gap, yes.
And then the one after that, the game directly after that, Metal Gear 2 Solid Snake, came out in was set in 1999. And then there was the original Metal Gear Solid, which came out on PlayStation, and that was set in 2005. Metal Gear Solid 2 Sons of Liberty was set in 2007 to 2009. Metal Gear Solid 4, Guns of the Patriots, was the one after that, and that took place in 2014. And then Metal Gear Rising Revengeance took place in 2018.
May I just make a comment here? That Metal Gear has all the problems of a time travel movies without involving time travel.
Without any time travel, yes.
That is absolutely correct. So like I said, the original intent was to sort of like, we're going to cut up, like, you know, the timeline, like X years to Y years, and speak about it. But let me just give you a sample of how this timeline reads. And like, it's very well done. It's all perfectly laid out. However, this will just hopefully exemplify what I'm talking about. In 1995, the U.S. learned that Outer Heaven, so that, like, some of this is out of context, sure, but here's what how the timeline sort of reads to you in parsing out the plot. The U.S. learned that Outer Heaven are building their own Metal Gear and decide to send Foxhound to destroy it. Big Boss, though, is behind both Outer Heaven and Foxhound. As head of Foxhound, Big Boss sends Frank Yeager to investigate Outer Heaven. Yeager, under the codename Gray Fox, fails and is captured. Big Boss then sends Solid Snake to rescue Gray Fox. Solid Snake saves Gray Fox, proceeds with his mission destroying the Metal Gear. But Big Boss now reveals that he is at the head of Outer Heaven and tries to stop Solid Snake. Big Boss reveals that he took back control of Foxhound to delay Solid's mission and finish building the Metal Gear. So, just that little slice... That's sort of tame compared to some of the other stuff that's in here.
That's ostensibly the simplest one, too.
Yeah,
that's the original Metal Gear,
really,
right?
But it's like exemplary of like how this all breaks down. Yeah. And yeah, sure, like, I guess if you think about it, then it does make sense, but nevertheless, Cody.
Okay. You're dealing with clones
of
one person spread over an entire timeline.
Yeah, over like three generations.
You're dealing with futuristic weaponry over many generations. You're dealing with allegiances that are
constantly shifting.
Yeah, but to the point where, because of the timeline is so diverted, that a character that they introduce in one, they have to explain its presence much later on, yeah. but in the prequel. So yeah, again, sure. Exactly. It's retroactively adding layers of drama which didn't originally exist in certain games.
Right.
Sure. And like,
there's so many, and there's also so many layers of like double crossing and all that stuff.
Yeah. So like usually, usually on Bon Mott's or other show, we try to come up with a funny logline. For this one, I basically came up with everyone's a clone of Snake and everyone's betraying each other. Like, yeah, there's a lot more to it than that, but some of it reads like that. You can like extract that from it.
It's easier to discuss who's not Snake than who actually is
who's
Snake.
A clone or like, yo. So the big reveal, let's just touch upon this. In Phantom Pain, the most recent one, which I voted my second number two game of the year last year, it was revealed that after the events of Ground Zeroes, the person you're like, the character looks like Snake. You assume it is him or Solid Snake, Big Boss, that is, slash either one. At the end of it, it's revealed that he's just some sort of random like soldier, like one of their trusted soldiers with no name guy that they facially like reconstructed and sort of brainwash hypno. Therapies, whatever, to think he's Big Boss, and that's who you're playing as the whole game. Then he becomes the clone that fights the original, in quotes, Big Boss slash Snake in whatever other game it was. So, like, it's all this ridiculously crazy. So, that's why we're not going to do it, like, line for line, if you will.
Yeah.
But just sort of, like, point out that, yes, these games hold their legacy going back to the original. Like, the first one came out in 87, I think you said?
87. So
and
yeah,
it was set
almost,
in 95 or whatever?
Yep, almost 30 years now of Metal Gear.
Sure, so yeah, this isn't quite like a anniversary in the sense that our Zelda episode and Resident Evil episodes were, but we're still doing a salute to it. And again, attempting to train the convoluted plot, we ourselves got too convoluted.
I was actually, while reading a condensed linear plot, recap.
Yeah, the timeline is very
I
well
was
done.
Getting confused over who was who.
Yeah.
So this is exactly. 30 years of basically Hideo Kojima.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which he's a great storyteller for individual pieces.
Yeah, sure.
Because the idea is he has a great twists, he has interesting plot developments that work in a video game. But when you actually try to
take it all together,
it is a headache. It's 30 years of making it up as he's going along.
Yeah, but you know what? I kind of like that. He like smashes this all together, and when you're playing the games in some weird way, it just kind of works.
You're right. Like, looking at it, like, it's weird because looking at it a big picture, you're like, this is a complete mess. It should never work.
Yeah.
But it works in the, like, within each game. I agree with that. And Steve, you played more games in the series than the rest, and Ian and I have. But even so, right, they're sort of self-contained. So even if you're like, you know, you're like, oh shit.
They are, but they all reference.
Right, they reference
other
things.
You can play them on their own, but they all reference.
Right,
everything that's happened.
So you can get more out of it.
You'll get a reference in the original Metal Gear Solid that you'll play through later on, like that you'll play through in Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater about, you know,
whatever it was.
Big Snake who eventually, the original Snake who eventually became Big Boss fighting the original boss who was his trainer, like whatever. It's
his mentor.
It's completely insane, but when you play through it, you're like, oh yeah, I kind of remember that reference from the last game. Like, it all kind of works out.
But it all works out if you don't pay too much attention to it. When you start trying to create a chronological and like very logical breakdown of it, it's like, oh, so in 87, Foxhound was anti-US and working with the Russians. Oh, but in 88, it started... it was infiltrated by the Chinese. Oh, in 89, it was back to the United States.
But actually, they were double agents and so forth. Yeah, sure. It's almost like every like spy thriller ever thrown into one.
I mean, it
should. I'm saying
it still makes sense.
It should be overwhelming, but somehow it works. Yes, I agree with that.
It's still at least a chronology that you can create and follow.
Sure, ostensibly.
Perhaps it doesn't make like logical sense that all these things would be happening one after another or on top of each other like that, but it kind of follows the idea of these large forces or, you know, groups that come together to like basically make money off of wars, and then ties in the idea that they are being infiltrated by governments and they are being infiltrated by other groups that are trying to, you know, tear them apart.
Things like that.
And of course that gets confusing.
That's all true. And like, so the cool thing is, one of the things I'll point out is that Ian mentioned in a precast that some of this ties into like real world events. So like the Cold War is sort of a big backstory setup, and like you know, the infiltrating the Russians, etc., and like all the PMCs that are involved.
All right, I don't know if we want to jump into this now, but this is my biggest beef with the timeline.
All right.
Mm-hmm. If you want to bring it, the idea that it's cool narrative that they're trying to meld real world events, like Cuban Missile Crisis and Gorbachev.
Afghan and all that. Khrushchev, I think.
Yeah, Khrushchev. But the problem is that you're introducing a, in a sense, a game changer for warfare, Metal Gear.
Right.
Which would have altered history.
Sure.
Incredibly. Well, and then
history is
also, but they're also referencing, yeah, but it's perfectly a one-for-one ratio.
Yeah, sure.
For the first half of the timeline.
Sure, you're right.
And then they do the futuristic thing of resource wars, which are a fair, that's supposed to happen in 1990, I think.
Sure.
But this was referenced back in the 80s original Metal Gear. So because they have, like, Metal Gear Solid was a reboot, but they kept the original storylines in the way of Metal Gear. So they had to include in the narrative
some of that stuff, yeah,
the issues that were raised. So it's in some ways it's like looking back at Back to the Future 2 and saying, oh, that year passed, let's have funny like what predictions they got right and not. But things wouldn't have gone down historically the same exact way if Metal Gears were an actual threat to the world.
But I don't think they have many historical events after 95. In fact, they don't. Right. I don't think have any. Said, which
a lot
is
of
like
it's backstory. Yes,
the historical events that happened after 95, which I believe the original Metal Gear game was where they perfected the first Metal Gear. The one before that, they have like this thing called a Shagohod, which is like an early prototype for Metal Gear.
It's like a blueprint or whatever for it.
Yeah, but in 1964, the rogue U.S. agent nukes Russia.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which would change world history. Sure,
that would certainly
course.
Change world history. Yeah, I mean, you're right. There are certainly things that
right. it's
would
like,
have been different.
I know you hate this phrase, but it's almost like he wants to have his cake and eat it too, in some sense, narratively, if you will. And sure, I get that, but I thought of a different analogy just now. It's almost like putting together a very elaborate jigsaw puzzle, which, taken in small bits, makes sense. When you look at the whole picture, it's just a jumble of like nothing.
Yeah, that's actually a very good analogy for that.
So, like, but even so, like, I still will give Kojima a lot of credit that, as you said, Steve-O, he sort of does indeed seem to have a vision, of course. It's just that it's a vision that no one else can sort of get behind.
May I make a actually critical assessment of this? There was an argument against one of the Uncharted games recently that they were more interested in set pieces that you'd have to do than necessarily the plot.
Yeah, that's true. It's been leveraged against it, yes.
I feel that there's a meta-narrative thing to say about Hideo Kojima, that he comes up with a good plot line he wants for his game and then has to fit it into the timeline he's created for the other games.
Yeah.
Which is why, Solids or Snake is the figurehead of all of these games. Who the people want to play. There was a big backlash against Raiden when he tried to introduce
the second Metal Gear Solid.
So he has to come up with an excuse on how Snake can exist
in
all these different timelines.
Time period, sure.
Time period. But, clones. Solid. sold there.
I think it worked out pretty well. Metal Gear Solid was the third game, so it wasn't even like he was deep into it at that point. Mm. You know, he did Metal Gear and Metal Gear 2, Solid Snake. And even at that point, Solid Snake was always a clone?
Well, see, that's the thing.
Like, it was, right? It was, so, like,
yeah, but you didn't know that. Like, it's retroactively revealed,
in
if
the
you
third,
will.
In Metal Gear Solid,
right.
He was actually...
That's what I'm saying. It becomes a bit egregious somewhat. So here's my question, right? If we could get Kojima on the horn. Did you, in fact, plan
on
like, have this vision all back planning out the original game, or did, again, like, you sort of like, oh, time for another game 5 years later. Let me see. I got to make a new plot, but also tied into every single other plot now that I've already gone with.
I think it's clearly going to be a mixture of both of those. Like, you know,
sure. I mean, that's
he
sort
obviously
of a joking
had
question,
ideas
but...
of where it was going, which is why he laid out like all these different things.
Sure.
But I'm not sure he ever thought that he was going to get
as many
however,
games out of
20
it.
Games out of it, or however
I suppose
many
that's
games there are.
Good point. Yeah, good.
It would be like if in the Indiana Jones trilogy, which the original ones, and then they want to do an update, but with Harrison Ford from back in the day, but in like the Cold War. How can we make Indiana Jones the idea of this action hero we want be in all these time periods?
And Crystal
again,
Skull.
Yeah, but that wasn't like,
clones.
That wasn't the like
alien clones.
One of the big responses to that is I don't want to play an old, or I don't want to see an old Indiana Jones. I want to see a young, like...
Sure.
The idea is that the hat and the whip are more important than Harrison Ford necessarily. Whereas in this one, you want Solid Snake to be in that, like... I haven't played the one where you're the old version of him. I think
I was
going to
say, isn't that Peace Walker?
That's Metal Gear Solid 4.
Okay. I know there was a version in which you did play that. Yeah.
Revolver Ocelot
Guns
has
Patriots.
The luxury of being a... villain throughout all time periods because they can make him young, as in Snake Eater.
He was an ally, though, in Phantom and Pain.
But he's a complicated anti-hero type, because he's a fan favorite.
Sure, yeah.
He's the kind of like pseudo-villain
right.
that you can have throughout. And he doesn't have to die, and he can age because he is that ever-present kind of baddie.
That's a good point.
Where Snake, you want to preserve him at the height of his power, at the like
apex of his abilities.
The stealth master there. You don't want to see a young up-and-coming Snake.
I mean, that's funny, yeah. I can't think of any other series, if you guys can, that comes anywhere close to like something like this in terms of plot and trying to tie all the games together.
No, not really. But what I will say is that you kind of see a young up-and-coming Snake in Metal Gear Solid 3. He's still... I mean, he's not really up-and-coming, but he's been trained under Boss, the boss, who's...
It's not the same Snake as in...
Right. But you do see, like, him, like, he's kind of rough and, like, he's kind of a rookie.
Sure.
And you see him go and, like, do his first, like, big solo mission, pretty much. And then you get to... Like, it's so weird because you get to see an old... Not even Snake, an old Snake clone, you know, like in Metal Gear Solid 4, Guns of the Patriots, the very next game, which was, I think, a PlayStation 3 release game.
I believe it was, yeah. Something like that.
And I remember playing that game, and it was kind of cool to have gone from, like, the really young Snake to, like, the really old Snake.
But so, they're not the same Snake.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, that's interesting. Yeah, but
like you said, the important thing is the, you know, the body armor. And
someone's
the, like,
called Snake,
you know,
and they got the bandana and a
the bandana,
an
eye patch. Yeah, and he's hiding under a box.
Sure. Yeah, you're right. Like, so, I don't know if there's much more to say, like, that we haven't said about the timeline.
I do have a response to you, though.
Okay.
I would say that the timeline is almost equivalent to trying to unite all the James Bonds together.
All right. I kind of like that.
Which, you have different actors playing different, like, yeah. It's the suit and the smarmy Britishness is what's important.
Yeah, but those movies are nowhere near as referential as the Metal Gear games are.
Sure, it's not like in Goldfinger, he's like, hey, remember back in Dr. No when X-Professor came in? Like, I get what you're saying, but...
There
like
are small references in the Bond movies, but it's nothing
like
this.
They're not all supposed to tie together like in one ginormous like ongoing
people
thread.
Have tried chronologically.
Sure.
Or I would say the Zelda games also, people have tried to tie in chronologically.
Kind of, but like even then, they never said like, you know... It's not quite the same thing, but I see your intent.
The developers themselves were not trying to do that in those instances. The developers are their, you know, directors.
Whereas
or whatever.
In this, they were. So, yeah, like, I'm not sure if there's much more to say about the timeline itself, but the other thing we can say, I think, to salute the series is that some of its gameplay was definitely innovative and iconic, and it remains so to this day.
Absolutely.
Like, yes, the box thing, sure, and all that. But just, like, I can't think of any other game, at least from the NES era, NES, SNES, maybe Sega-ish era, that focused on stealth, like, instead of just blowing everything away.
Yeah.
Right? So that, I mean, the box thing sort of came out of that. In order to move around unseen, sure, you had to hide under boxes. But that was a mechanic that you had not seen before, and if you had, it was not handled as well.
And I never finished or played all the way through the Metal Gear or Metal Gear 2, but where I really came into the series was Metal Gear Solid.
Solid, yeah.
For the
PlayStation. I think that's where most fans, like, a lot of, real quickly, our generation probably started there.
I tried to get through Metal Gear.
Yeah, those games are freaking
It was Nintendo hard.
They're
yeah, of
incredibly
course.
Hard.
Sure.
But there's a lot of really cool stuff that came, you know, innovations and a bunch of also one-trick ponies that I thought were really awesome.
You're going to say like the Psycho Mantis thing?
Yeah, for sure. There's the Psycho Mantis fight that's just so crazy where you had to, or you didn't have to do this, but to make it a lot easier.
But if you did,
you could change the ports that your controller was in to fight him, and he wouldn't be able to read your mind and see what you're going to do next. There are a bunch of really cool boss fights, especially in Metal Gear Solid, that were just
that's
like
iconic,
really interesting.
Sure, for the series, for sure.
In 3, there's a very famous one, which there's an elderly sniper.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, that's so good.
Which, if you wait,
I believe his
dies
name is
old age.
Yeah, I believe his name was The End.
Yes.
Yes.
And
that's right.
Yeah, that was a really cool fight. And I never waited for him to die. I mean, you could, like, I forget what it was. I think time would go normally even if you turned off your PlayStation during that fight. So you could, like, turn it off and wait a couple days, come back, and he would be dead. I fought him regularly, but that might not even be true. You might have had to, like, leave it on or something.
Sure, it's something like that, though.
After a certain amount of time, he would just die of old age.
Sure, which is like kind of, I mean, like, you don't see that very often, if at all, in many other games.
Actually, what I'll give it credit for is, and something you don't, usually, for you either have a great protagonist that you're following, or you have great villains that you remember.
Yeah.
Metal Gear has always been able to capture both.
Both. Yeah, yeah, that's a good point. I completely agree. That's a very good point. Indeed.
So, well, speaking of some of those boss fights, I have a couple of them listed. Okay. I just wanted to, the first boss fight in Metal Gear Solid was Revolver Ocelot. And it was so cool. I just remember it being like maybe the coolest boss fight I'd ever seen up to that point. And then there were a couple that even eclipsed that probably in that same game. But when you're fighting him, you have to like literally shoot around corners. You have to use deflections of bullets in order to hit him because he's too fast. And like if you get in his line of sight, he'll just shoot you. So that was really cool. There's one with Vulcan Raven. There's one boss called Vulcan Raven where you basically are just laying down bombs. And you have to wait till he goes over them to, you know, C4 to, like, set it off. There's a sniper battle in that one, too. I think boss's name is Sniper Wolf.
Yes,
that's correct, yeah.
That was just the craziest sniper battle I'd ever seen in a game up to that
point. But also it was heartbreaking as well.
Yeah, and it was very, very sad, too. Right. You're right.
That's a good point. Like, so that's one thing I'll touch back on. Yeah, even though it seems like I said, a bit ridiculous on the surface and all convoluted, he can have, there are definitely moments of, like, affecting moments.
High emotion,
yeah,
for sure.
Within
the
games, even though like it's framed by this somewhat like semi-serious, like, you know, world conflict, etc. Like, I don't know. Like, there are definitely, you know, touches of levity here and there, of course, as well. But nevertheless, it can, many of them have an affecting story that if you're invested in the characters and the world and so forth, like, might mean something to you.
What I also like is that, in a way, Metal Gear Solid, although it does face world-changing events, it's very focused on like almost a tight-knit community of people
who
have either fought with each other against
other
enemies. A band
of brothers, if you will.
Or have been kind of had their reputations precede them.
Yeah.
Or they have rivalries. But these are the people you know. You're like as Snake, whether you're doing Venom Snake or Clone A or Clone B, you're dealing with people who are also special, like, psyops type individuals, and that relationships really speak through very well throughout the games.
No, I definitely agree with
absolutely,
all that.
Absolutely,
it's definitely one of the most unique things about the franchise at large, I would say, for sure. It's, you know, like I said, you don't often see that. It's difficult to capture that in such a huge, spanning group of games.
Yeah, Kojima does such a good job of doing that, putting and doing it in a small amount of time, making these characters, you know, making these high emotion situations. You know, you go from fighting, like we're talking about, fighting the sniper battle to, when it's over, just this really kind of drawn out but affecting scene where you go and speak to Sniper Wolf afterwards. And it's just really, I haven't seen much of anybody else that's been able to do it in such a way, especially in those really micro elements of
within that
character development and character interaction.
Moving off characters for a second, I want to talk about Metal Gear Solid 2, where you're basically on the same area for most of the game, but you're witnessing its collapse and destruction, both by what you've caused and also what the villains are causing as this battle wages on. So you have to revisit areas that are basically completely new puzzle mechanics in order to navigate. And I actually thought that was the first Metal Gear Solid kind of had that, but not really. Basically, you'd move on from area to area.
Right.
I thought it was very effective, like the constant revisiting that you had to do in the second one.
Yeah, for sure. Like I said, like there were many mechanics, like even in Phantom Pain, like you sort of, if that's going to be his last Metal Gear game, which it looks like it almost certainly is, he went out with like a big flourish, like taking bits and pieces, a lot of elements from all the other games that he had come before, and sticking them together in a way, a more coherent whole than I guess the plot will ever be. But it was just like perfectly well designed. And like you said, those are like the puzzle bosses, like figuring out like what to do against whoever, like the end thing, like you were saying.
Yeah, those were always really cool.
And the affecting cutscene, moments as well. Mm-hmm. Which, yeah, and like I know like it's, the series again has been accused, if you will, of like basically vomiting exposition at you a lot of times.
They have to, though.
But like, so yeah, it's sort it of like necessary
in order
sense
to make it make any sense.
And I think it probably would lose something without that. You would obviously get a lot less out of it. You wouldn't know what's going on as much. So like, maybe you just sort of have to sacrifice that narratively, which we discussed about.
And
like,
I'll
you know,
also say, as
it might not have worked in a different setting, is what I'm saying.
Even though a lot of the exposition is just direct talk about what's going on,
yeah.
It's written in a pretty solid way. Like I've always really liked the dialogue between characters. It's always seemed, even though it's completely unnatural for them to be saying these things, the dialogue has always seemed natural to me while I'm playing the game.
That's the weird thing. I guess,
you know, it becomes, once you get into the Metal Gear Solid world, which doesn't take very long at all, you kind of just expect characters to talk like that, and it's natural, and it doesn't throw you, it doesn't bring you out of the game or anything like that.
Sure.
I think it's just because they throw in little jokes here and there. They throw in little things that make you more aware that you're in the Metal Gear world.
I think the description of Metal Gear world is very apropos, because he establishes a universe which doesn't make sense necessarily in our universe, but it's consistent throughout the universes that he built.
Yes.
From game to game.
Agreed.
So, yeah. You'll have long conversations with people on the radio, like the radio chatter, that don't make much sense for why I just got done killing five people and we're going to talk at length about something
Fox die or whatever. Yeah.
But it's consistent. It is he plays by the rules he establishes, even
exactly.
though
I was waiting for you to say that,
difficult rules to sometimes follow.
Since you mentioned the Kodak, I had a couple other notes about like these little, as I called them earlier, like one trick pony tricks that he does that I thought were really like brilliant. Two of them from the first Metal Gear. The first one is the torture scene from that one, where you have to like spray ketchup on yourself so that the guard thinks you're dead, so that the guard comes in, you can like disarm the guard and get out.
I don't remember that.
One of the best like torture scene / prison scene things that I've seen probably ever in a game. That was great. Another one was, I don't know if you guys will remember this, but in that game, in order to contact Meryl, one of the people that you talk to on the codec a lot, you had to have the box for the game, and her codec channel was on the back of the box. That was how it tells you. That's how the game tells you to find her, which I thought was really, really funny.
Yeah, I remember if you weren't playing with the box, I think they make a vague reference to it's on the back of a box.
Yeah.
And you could spend hours searching around.
You have to figure it out somehow.
No, that's really funny.
And this was like in the early days of the internet, so unless you're really on the ball, you wouldn't have been able to go and find. I mean, sure, it was much harder than pirate, sure. And then the last one I just wanted to mention was from Ground Zeroes, where Kojima programmed in that you could rescue him.
Oh yeah,
from
that
camp.
Was really good. I do remember that. It was really funny.
But, like, just he loves doing those little things that are just really clever and like funny and whatever. They're little throwaway things in terms of the plot, but in terms of your memory of the games, there are some of the things that you remember the most.
It definitely highlights. I believe I said like this is also a running joke within the whole series, but since you mentioned that Ground Zero thing, when you do the mission, when you rescue the hostage that is him essentially, he of course says, "What took you so long, Snake?"
Yeah. Yeah.
So like another like perfect like little reference.
Oh, I have one more thing from the Psycho Mantis fight actually. In the first Metal Gear Solid. When you first fight Psycho Mantis, it looks like your computer, or it looks like your TV screen just turns off.
Yeah.
And then comes back on. If you guys will remember the way the inputs worked on old TVs.
Yes, I do, yes.
It would say like video on the top, in the top left of your screen. So they did it so it looked like that, except for it said Hideo. And at first you were like, what the hell is this? Like, why did it just turn to my VCR or whatever? But it was actually just, you know, him screwing around with you.
He's his master of interface screw.
So good.
I believe so. I think there's something we didn't mention. I'm pretty sure it's damn sure it's from Metal Gear. The fission mailed thing, if you know what I'm talking about. Instead of mission failed, it says fission mailed.
Yeah.
Like, again, like little interface screws that make you be like, is my game glitching out? Like, what the fuck is happening? Here, you're right. He's sort of a master of slow rolls in that sense.
Yeah.
Of messing with those kinds of conventions. And yeah, I agree. Like, that was pretty revolutionary when it came out, and he stuck with it and evolved himself with it as well. There's a lot of things you can say, like, positive, both, I would say, more positive and negative, but sure, you can nitpick it here and there if you want, and certainly some of that's valid, but you know, I think you have to give Kojima and the series itself a shitload of credit for its impact on games and from other like things stole from it, if you will,
and the Glenn Beck board to make out
that too
exactly. So Solid Snake is up here, and then but he's a clone of Liquid Snake, etc. So therefore, like, just Snake is just circled in the middle of the board. It all like points back to Snake.
It all comes back to Snake. But I mean, what I will say is that Metal Gear made stealth games a thing.
Yeah, I agree with that. You know, like, you have to give it credit, if nothing else, on that front, for sure.
They existed before Metal Gear, but they wouldn't still. Yeah. They probably wouldn't exist in any kind of decent form.
I think they were perfected by it.
Now.
It created the stealth for consoles.
Yeah.
And it created... I don't think I ever played a stealth game before this, but it created after Metal Gear Solid came out, it was immediately the top of the hill. I mean, that was in discussions for best game ever when it came out.
Sure.
For good reason.
Yeah, deservedly,
It was basically like playing a spy movie.
Yeah, it made you feel like a badass because of that. And you're like, again, it wasn't just like a platform shooter or like a Contra thing.
Yeah.
Like, it made you think about it. It made you plan and, you know, have a strategy to get around the guys and... You know, learn a level and know where the guards are going to be.
The first time a computer sees your footprints and starts following you, you know, in this game, and you sees your footprints in the snow and starts following you around and trying to find you, is like mind blowing. That generation.
I remember when Metal Gear Solid 2 came out. The idea that I can shoot all the bottles off of bar,
the physics stuff,
was mind blowing. Like, I never seen so this advanced. Yeah. Quite a bit.
And then I think it was also in 2 was the first time that, like, in any game, I think, that you could move bodies. So you could, like, knock out or kill enemies and then move their bodies around. Into lockers
that.
Or, you know, put them wherever, like, move them out of the way. And that's such a big thing in games now.
You're right. If not the first, it definitely codified a lot of this stuff and, you know, sort of ingrained it into a lot of design of stealth, any stealth influence or based game that came afterwards. So I think, you can look, again, check out the Metal Gear timeline and give a shout out to Alex, whatever he's working on. You got to give a lot of credit to both Kojima and his team and all the games in this entire franchise. They have a huge impact on the business and the design in general. And hopefully, maybe he'll eventually get to make another one. I think we might do an episode later on, maybe next season, about the nasty breakup with him, Kojima versus Konami, if you will.
Yeah.
But that's sort of beside the point for now. Check out the timeline and...
Play the games; they're fun.
Yeah, play them all. Hopefully, they do a bundle. Actually, I like to see a remaster bundle of a bunch of them.
Yeah,
if they if not all, like a whole bunch, you know, like 4 or 5 or whatever. But other than that, I think it's time for me to crawl back into a cardboard box and stealth on out of here.
I feel asleep, Jonathan Manser.
I'm gonna also go back into my cardboard box.
Snake.
This has been Syntax Error. Thank you as always for listening, and we will see you next time.
Music by Stephen Ormosi. Editing and engineering by Scott Thurlow.
Syntax Error is part of a Lost Signals Productions. All rights reserved.